So, great. We're going to do our vision statement, but we're going to do it different than we've ever done it before in our lives. But it's okay, you're flexible. On the front of your bulletin, you'll see our mission statement. You folks over here start with the words, "A vibrant." You folks here in this wing start out with reaching out. You folks start with telling the good news. And you folks start out with making disciples. We're going to do it bung, 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 just right in a row. All right? And you guys in the back, pick a side. Okay. Here we go. A vibrant, oh, you did it very well. We'll do it again next week if I don't kick stuff over. All right. We're going to welcome our friends who are joining us on Facebook and online. We hope that this is a time of worship that helps you. I know that there are many people today who are in the hospital, who are at home, who are not feeling well. We've got some folks who are on the road heading for the Southland for the winter. And I know we've got a couple friends who are in the Southland heading back to Illinois for the winter. So we've got folks traveling all over the place. So if you're online, please let us know that you're out there and say hello and check in with us. We would love to hear from you. We're going to continue our worship with Psalm 29 in the hymnal 761. I'm going to ask Steve to come up and lead that. It's up on the screen as well. Thank you.
Now, there we go. Would you like to stand for this call to worship, please? It's as we gather, we are called to worship. And those of you that are online, we invite you as well to read along in this opportunity to begin our worship service. So ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders, the Lord upon many waters.
The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty.
The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars.
The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
The Lord makes Lebanon to skip like a calf, and Siron like a wild young ox. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness.
The Lord shakes the wilderness.
The voice of the Lord makes the oaks to whirl and strips the forests bare.
And in his temple all cry, Lord.
The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as ruler forever.
May the Lord give strength.
Invite the praise team to come up, and we'll continue with singing our songs of praise.
Good morning.
Morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made for you, for me, to do what? Rejoice. And be glad
in it.
Amen. Doesn't matter if it's raining and cold outside.
Yes.
God is still good. Hallelujah. We come into your presence for sin. Come into your presence with praise. Enter your gates with thankful hearts. We are going to celebrate. All of heaven's waiting. Power is on its way. So we shout hallelujah, lift into ya a mighty roar of praise. Hear this earth of the highest. our praise. That's what we came here for. You deserve the highest praise we can give and more. Lord, we give you our praise. That's what we came here for. We come into your presence with singing. Come into your presence with praise. We enter your gates with thankful hearts. We are going to celebrate. All of heaven's waiting. Carries on its way. So we shout hallelujah. Lifting to you a mighty roar of praise. Yeah, you deserve the highest praise. We can't give it more. Lord, we give you our praise. That's what we came here for. You deserve the highest praise. We can't give it more. Lord, we give you our praise. That's what we came here for. Everything within me reaches out to you. Your power, your majesty, grace and mercy to the singing, the dancing, hearts and voices raise. You have set your people free. Now the house is filled with praise. Everything within me reaches out to you. Your power, your majesty, grace and mercy through. Let me singing, the dancing, hearts and voices raise. Oh, you have set your people free. The house is filled with praise. Yes, it is, Lord. You deserve the highest praise. We can give you more. Lord, we give you our praise. That's what we came here for. You deserve the highest praise. We can give you more. Lord, we give you our praise. That's what we came here for. You deserve the highest praise. You deserve the highest praise. You deserve the highest praise. That's what we came here for. Amen. There is no doubt that our God deserves the highest praise that we can give. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
When the pastor sent through the scriptures for this week, this song just immediately came to mind. Such a powerful song.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Would you join me, please, with our unison prayer this morning? Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we ask your blessing on the people in this place. May the disparaging find hope and the proud be humbled. May the doubting find faith and the anxious be encouraged. May the tempted find help and the sorrowful find comfort. May the weary find rest and the strong be renewed. May the lonely find a friend, and the cluttered find stillness. May the older one find consolation, and the younger be inspired. And may you find glory in our worship, and we find joy in you. Now, Lord, pour out your spirit of grace and love today as we together we worship you. This we pray to your glory and in your name. Amen. Our first scripture lesson, and I'll give you a little time to find it in your Bibles, if you'd like it in the pew Bibles. For you at home watching, you'd like to watch along as this is read. But it's in the New Testament in your pew Bible, page 248. I'd like to kind of set the stage here just a little bit. Of course, this is the book of Revelation, the Revelation to St. John. And what he is seeing is God on the throne. And he has this scroll in his hand. And it's sealed. I don't know if you've ever seen that done. In olden days where they take some wax and, you know, they would seal up a parchment or a letter. And there was an angel with a loud voice. And it said, "Who in heaven or on earth can open this scroll?" But there wasn't anybody who could do that. And so St. John was sad that nobody could open the scroll. But then one of the elders said, "Weep not, John, because there is one who can open that scroll." And John looked again, and he could see a lamb that looked like it had just been slaughtered go up to the throne and take the scroll and open it. And we continue on with our lesson this morning on verse 8. "And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and with golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, 'Worthy art thou to take the scroll and to open its seals, for thou wast slain, and by thy blood didst ransom men for God from every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and hast made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on earth.' And then I looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads and myriads and thousands, saying with a loud voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing.' And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all therein saying, 'To him who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever.' And the four living creatures said, 'Amen.' And the elders fell down and worshiped." This is the word of God for the people of God. Okay, well, if we have some kids who'd like to come up, we'll do a little time together here, get myself kind of set up. You can kind of sit down on the floor down here. I'm going to sit on this stool because I found that if I sit on a step, I have to have Lily pull me up. She'd do it, but, okay, we will not ask her to do that. All right. Get all my paraphernalia here. I was searching around in my dresser drawer in our bedroom, and this is what I found. I shouldn't have found it, but I did. Men tend to keep things they shouldn't. What is that, kids? It's a shirt. It's got holes in it, doesn't it? So what would you call this shirt for those watching back there? This is up there on the at home. What would you kind of a shirt would you call this? That doesn't fit in with what I'm trying to say here today. But I suppose there's a message there. What would you call this kind of a shirt? How about a holy shirt?
Yeah,
a holy shirt. You got Christian. Adam has Christian holy socks. Well, that's great. Now, I've got this book. You've seen it in the pews and stuff. What is this book? It's the Bible, isn't it? And what else is on there? It call it, well, you just said it a minute ago. What's that first word? Holy. Now, wait a minute now. I'm getting confused. Is this shirt like the Holy Bible, or is this Bible like a shirt with holes in it? No. Yeah, they kind of hesitate a little bit. He's trying to sneak one over on us here. No, but that's because holy is one of those strange words that you say it, but you spell it different ways. Oh, a homophone. That's right. And see, you can see that. It's spelled H-O-L-E-Y. Holy. Okay? So, that's one. And then the other way would be H-O-L-Y, wouldn't it? So you can see that. All right? Holy. Two different things. Two different spellings, but they mean something quite different. What do you think this spelling means? What does it mean to be H-O-L-Y? My dad said there's no wrong answers. Yeah, it's more of a belief. In fact, holy means that it's different and that it's extra special and set apart. I've got two books. I brought another book up here from the library. Is this a holy book? Probably not, because it's not extra special. What makes the Bible extra special? Because it's the story of God. We used to be, when I was growing up, we called it His story. You know, with history, His story, God's story. So it is special. It's a book, but it is set apart. It is special. It is different. It's the story of God's love for us. God is holy because He is the most special thing ever, ever existing. He's most powerful. He knows everything. He loves more than anybody that you ever know, even your parents or your grandparents or a friend or a sister or a brother. And that's hard to believe, but that is true. That's how much God is holy. Now, I ask if Ella would do something for me here. Can we be holy? Okay, and St. Peter tells us, you want to come up here by me instead of me trying to bend down there, Ella? In his first letter, let me get the microphone here. Tell everybody what 1 Peter says in the first chapter, verse 16.
For it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy.
You shall be holy because I am holy. This is what God had revealed to St. Peter. So we can be holy because God is holy and we were created in His image. All right, one final word here. What's this one? Glory. Glory, for those of you who are watching or listening. What's glory? Yeah, I think that would be a good way to look at it. Glory is something very magnificent, very lovely, very great. Now, the greatest glory of God is Jesus. Because Jesus gave His life, He forgave our sins, and we have the promise of life everlasting. That way, that's how God shows how holy He is, by revealing and giving us the glory of Jesus Christ. I am holy, special, because Jesus is the glory of God. God's holiness that we can have. Okay? All right. Well, thanks for participating. You have a good rest of your day. And those of you who are going down to Sparks, I know that Laura Jo's in the back.
This is the time that we come before the Lord in prayer. I was just thinking, which is always a dangerous thing, you know, some people really shudder when I say I've been thinking. But there's an old song that just the words, it's really simple, and it just says, thank you, God, for sending Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you came. Holy Spirit, won't you teach me more about that precious name? And I just thought, you know, the words are so simple, yet they say so much. And sometimes we kind of complicate things a lot. I was thinking about how people in the Bible prayed, come, let us worship, let us bow down, let us kneel before the Lord our God. Sometimes they stood with hands upraised. Sometimes they prostrated themselves flat on the floor as they came before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We're not His equal. He's the boss. He's the boss. So let's come before the Lord this morning. Let's lift before Him the things that are in our hearts. Father, we bless You this morning. We are thankful. We're thankful that Jesus came, that He died in our place on the cross. Lord, we're thankful even more that He rose from the dead and that He's alive and that He lives in us and through us. And Father, there are so many things going on in the world today. We hardly know where to start to pray. We think of those of our congregation who are sick. We think of the families of the kids who were injured and the one who was killed in the accident recently. Lord, You command us in Your word to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Lord, we think of all the rioting that's going on. Lord, how this world needs Jesus. How this world needs Jesus. And Father, You're the one who's commanded us to go out into the world, to take the good news, to spread that news of Jesus. Help us to do that, Lord. Be with all those who mourn. Be with those who rejoice. Be with each one of us, Father, this morning. We ask in Your precious name. Let's pray together. The Lord's Prayer. But let's not rush it this morning. Let's just take it gently. Let the words sink into our hearts. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Am I on now? What I said was, I'm going to teach you a Hebrew word today. The Hebrew word is tithe, T-I-T-H-E, tithe. And the Hebrew word tithe means tenth. Now, it just so happens that on this table today, there are 10 $1 bills. And if you took one of them off, you would have a tenth. So if your grandma sends you birthday money, and you get $10 in your birthday card, if you were a tither, someone who tithed, you would give $1 to the work of God. Sometimes we do that within the church. We give a tenth to the work of God. Well, but there's just a problem here. Did you know not everybody does that? The average American doesn't tithe. Usually in a church, 10 to 25% will tithe, but the average American, if they got $10 from their grandma, they would give, here's two dimes, and here's four pennies, they would give 24 cents, 2.4%. But some of them would give three dimes, and some would give four dimes, 2.4%, 3%, 4% is what most people give. But this is just, you know, birthday money. But what if you had some other kind of money? What if you did a really good job for somebody and they gave you $100? So the tithe of that would be $10. But somebody in Heyworth earns $1,000 a week, $52,000 a year. So if you had, instead of $1 bills, if you had $100 bills and you had 10 of them on that table, that's somebody's paycheck every week. And they would give, if they were tithing, $100 to the work of God. Why? Why? There's this verse of scripture that we looked at not long ago about, we love because God first loved us. Now, this isn't Holy Scripture, but it's a really good idea. We give because God first gave to us. Why would I give to God and His work and His ministry? Because God gave me the breath of life. I'm still breathing. There's this cross over here, and Jesus died on it, and I have salvation. There's just any number of things that God has done for us. And, you know, sometimes we get in a rut. We get in a routine. We're people of habit. We really, truly are. Sometimes, usually around this time of year, we need to take a look at and really do the math. What are we giving? How are we being thankful to God? How do we show that gratitude to God? And so today I just ask you to go home, look at your pay stub, do the math, see how you're doing. And every one of you are going to give whatever you want to give. Because, Lord, help me if I said, this is how much you have to give. One time I had somebody tell me, well, I just got to pay my dues when I give to the offering plate. Can you imagine if we split up the budget of the church into monthly or yearly dues? Can you imagine getting a note from the church? This would be one for us to add to the list of things to do, Karen, is let's send out monthly statements to people and tell them what their dues are for that month. Split up the whole budget, we'll just divide it up. Some of you would be relieved. And others of you would be going, don't you dare send that to me. And you'd be right. God wants you to give what you want to give. we would appreciate you take a look at it. And stewardship is always an issue here at the United Church of Heyworth and at every church. Amen. Okay. For the last few weeks, we've been talking about the Lord's Prayer. Today, we come to sermon number 5, the very last sermon in the series on the Lord's Prayer. We started out with the great introduction, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name is the first thing, is the first petition. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, all God-related petitions. And then we go into the human-related petitions of give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our sins, help us to heal those relationships either with God or with others who have been damaged, and then lead us not into temptation. As we look to the future, how can we stay true and faithful to God through all the things? And now we've got to the end of all the petitions. And we get to the end, which is really about the glory of God. And Steve was at it with the boys and girls about his holy T-shirt, and it would have been helpful if I hadn't hollered out it was a rag, but I had to. I couldn't contain myself. There are just moments. There's this smart aleck who lives deep inside of me, and I contain him most of the time, but there are other moments, and you just saw one, about the glory of God, and we end it with the glory of God. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Sounds great. But you know, as you live your life and I've lived mine, let's go to we hear things as we're growing up. In our families, we hear things as we grow up. Now, one time I was at Grandpa and Grandma's, and Grandpa and Grandma had 6 kids, and all 6 kids got married. And all the married people had children. So Grandpa and Grandma were 12, that's 14, 18 grandchildren. There were 32 of us in this little 2-bedroom, 1-bathroom home on Elm Street in downtown Hersher. And somebody got the brilliant idea that before we ate in that bungalow, that we should say the Lord's Prayer together. Now, Grandpa and Grandma raised those boys and girls of theirs, Missouri Senate Lutheran, and each of them had been to confirmation, and they knew what the Lord's Prayer was. I'll tell you right now. But what happened was their sons and daughters fell in love with people who belonged to other churches. My mother married a Methodist. My uncle married a Methodist, so there were 2 Methodists in the group, and we had some ELCA people in the group, and then we had some Christians in the group, and we had this one family that belonged to some community church of some kind. And so when we were getting ready to do the Lord's Prayer, it was a train wreck is what it was. We started out okay. It really did. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Breathe. Give us this day our daily bread, because that's really the reason we were saying the prayer anyway, because we were waiting to eat what Grandma had prepared. And forgive us our sins, debtors, trespasses, as we forgive those who sin, debt, and trespass against us. A little shaky. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And then, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory and forever and ever and ever and ever. Amen, amen, amen. And in my little boy brain, if you don't know the Lord's Prayer the way that I know the Lord's Prayer, because I've been to Sunday school, man. I've been to church. I have heard it over and over and over again. And the adults in my life got it wrong. Wrong. How could they mess up the Lord's Prayer? These are all people who go to church and every week they get it wrong. And then they come to Grandma's house and they get it wrong. The idea in my little brain that somebody could do something different was beyond the realm of possibility. Because in my brain, you were either right or you were wrong. We dealt with it. I just decided to be quiet for once in my life and not say anything. Well, I knew that some of my aunts and uncles were certainly not paying attention in their churches, obviously. But then, as I grew and matured, when I was a boy, when I was a child, I thought like a child. When I became a man, I thought like a man. And then I felt this call to ministry, and I decided to go to seminary. Now, this wonderful picture is a Gothic building. My seminary looked like that a lot. I could not find a picture that I could show online, but that's pretty much what seminary looked like. And today, instead of just coming to church, I want you to be seminary students just for a little bit today in the sermon, all right? All of you are checking out seminary, and some of you are wanting to come, maybe think about ministry. You want to be a pastor in a local church. You've been in churches before, and you say, I could do what he does. And so some of you are going, I could check this out. But some of you are more into education and teaching, and so what you want to do is look at Christian education and how do you help children learn and youth learn and adults learn. So maybe you're looking at a master's in religious education. You would be looking for a master's in divinity. And you folks, that church stuff is interesting, religious education is interesting, but what's really important is chaplaincy. Being in the hospitals, being in the military, maybe being a counselor. A pastoral counselor, how the pastor might refer someone to me so I could help them with their life and their challenges and their problems. I would like to do that. That's maybe where you are. But you guys over here, you have come to seminary on a long journey to become seminary professors. You want to get a PhD, but you got to start out at seminary. And it's going to be great because you're going to be the scholars. You're going to get out the big fat books and read them and study them and write papers and put them in peer-reviewed journals, and people are going to discuss and debate your ideas. It's going to be marvelous. You're going to stand in front of classrooms of seminary students like this and teach them. Wouldn't that be wonderful? But I'm going to tell you, every single one of you, if you're going to come to seminary, you're going to go to a New Testament class. Nobody gets out of seminary without first going to New Testament. So let's talk about New Testament for a minute. Today, class, we are in Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. In particular, we're looking at verse 13. We're looking at that last tag, that statement, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Now, in seminary, it is very possible and expected that your beliefs that you have held all of your lives are going to be challenged. Just because you've always believed it doesn't mean that somebody isn't going to maybe push you a little bit. And being the fine seminary professor I am with my bow tie and my jacket with the elbow pads on it, I'm going to be able to do that for you today. Now, our pericope, our passage of scripture is the Lord's Prayer. And we're in that last section, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Have you always said that? In your prayer life, have you always added that line to your prayers? This is when you get to participate in class. Yes, some of you have. Okay, very good. Good, good, good. Why? Because it's in the Bible. It's in the Bible I read. So, but they taught us in Sunday school. It's what they taught in vacation Bible school. I've learned it my whole life. I've been coming to church all my whole life, and that's what they've always said. Next slide. Well, students, let me inform you that in the lives of these four theologians of the early church, Tertullian, who was in the 2nd and 3rd century, and remember, when we're in the 2nd century, we're in the 100s, Tertullian is known best for his work in the idea of the doctrine of the Trinity. It goes back that far. Next, we have Origen, who goes to the 3rd century, and he was the one who developed the idea of interpreting the scripture by allegory. When you look at the old story of the prodigal son, a certain man had a son. The certain man stands for God, and everybody and everything in the story stands for God. When the son comes back, the ring stands for authority, and there's all of these things that stand for something else. And that was Origen who started that back in the third century. Ambrose in the fourth century was really our apologist. That means that he was the one who was going to argue for the faith against the pagans. And his understanding really helped us understand what is the core of orthodoxy as opposed to these heretical beliefs. It was also Ambrose who baptized Augustine, who was probably one of the most creative thinkers since St. Paul. None of these four famous theologians ever prayed, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Class, why are you doing that? Well, because I've always done it. Well, let's take a look at something else here, class. Sometimes when we go to our Greek manuscripts, we have to look back at the ancient times when we were reading things. Sinaiticus, 300s, the other ones, 400, 500, 600. And in all of those manuscripts, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever," isn't there. But wait a minute, wait a minute. There is one little oops, maybe. Hang on, let me see if I can find it here in my notes, class. In the Didache, a writing that happened in about 150 AD. The Apostle John dies about 100 AD, so about 50 years later, there's a book called the Didache. Don't think of it as Holy Scripture, but maybe more like an instruction manual. It was called the Didache, the Lord's Teaching Through the 12 Apostles to the Nations, chapter 8, section 2. "Neither pray ye as the hypocrites, but as the Lord hath commanded in his gospel, so pray ye. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done as in heaven on earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt as we also forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory forever." And then 8:3, "Thrice a day pray ye in this fashion." Didn't say anything about the kingdom, but it's the earliest thing we have that ties in this one phrase to the end of the prayer. So what has been added is a doxology. Now, doxa is the word meaning praise or glory. Logos means speaking. So doxology is not just the song we play at the end when we take the offering. Back in the old days before the pandemic, we bring the offering forward and we'd hit the chord, and we'd all stand and go, "Praise God from whom all blessings." Remember that? That's the doxology, to stand, praise, glory, standing, speaking, okay? It appears from the scholars, class, that someone in the second century added, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory." They added a doxology because the people were praying and sudden it was part of their worship, but it wasn't in the scripture. But we keep doing it, and some of us do and some of us don't. And doxologies aren't just for us. They're for other places in the Bible. Let's show what King David has. Let's read this one together. This is a doxology. "Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all." This is 1 Chronicles 29 and 11, and I've italicized the words power, glory, and kingdom. They're not in the same order that we pray them normally, but King David, in a prayer, added this doxology, this praise, to the end of his prayer. And so now we end the Lord's Prayer traditionally as Protestants with this doxology: "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Next slide. I was working at St. Joe's Hospital in Breeze, Illinois. And we're standing there having a hallway huddle. And all the leaders of the different departments and areas of the hospital were standing there. I was representing the chaplains that day. And somebody said, let's pray the Our Father together. Now, Our Father is Catholic code for the Lord's Prayer, for those Protestants who don't know that. And we're buzzing right along, and you can tell who the Catholics are. And you can tell who the Protestants are. Because the Catholics are going, for thine is the kingdom, and deliver us from evil. And the Protestants are going, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. And the Catholics are looking at us going, what are you doing? And the Protestants are looking at them going, what are you doing? You just left out the whole last line. Maybe we can do things different. But why? Why do we do it? Well, part of it's tradition. Let's go to the next slide. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. The kingdom, one of the first petitions we talk about with the Lord is, thy kingdom come, the reign of God in your life, in my life, here, now, not just when after you die. How is God reigning and ruling in my life now? So all of these petitions I have prayed for God and for myself and for others, how can I say, for thine is the kingdom? I want what you want, God. I can't believe, and I don't even understand why you would pick me of all people on the planet to do what I get to do. Why? Thy kingdom. I want to be one of your subjects, and I don't even know why you'd want me in your kingdom, but you do. Thy kingdom come. Use me. Use other people as you will. Thy kingdom come. Let's go to this. Ah, the kingdom, a realm. Kind of looks like Disneyland, doesn't it? Ah, there are certain wonders about a castle and a kingdom, and there's all the trappings that go along with it, the moat and all. That in this area, I'm not in charge. That in this area of my life, I'm not in charge. That the king is in charge. One of our songs, Be Thou My Vision, has a line that talks about High King of Heaven. The High King of Heaven is in charge of our lives. And so when we ask all these things, it is asking the Sovereign One, saying, will you please, if it fits into your kingdom, if it fits into the vision of your kingdom, would you do this? For thine is the kingdom. Next. And the power. You can pray any prayer you want. And you can say, Pastor, I prayed a prayer about this. I do not have the power to fix it. Lord, somebody who's been involved in an automobile accident. I can't fix it. Lord, somebody graduated from college. Marvelous. I'll celebrate with you. But I didn't earn the degree. I don't have the power. The power comes from God. For thine is the power. Thou is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Glory forever. That this is not just something we do once a day, or even in the old days with the Didache, three times a day, but this is about God's power and God's glory and God's kingdom. And we end it as we stand and praise and talk the praise, the doxology, the praise talking. We end it in praise because God is the one who is able to meet our needs. God is the one who has the power to answer. God is the one who works in our lives each and every day. So, class, that's kind of like what seminary is. Sometimes it's challenging. Now, if this was really seminary, I would give you an assignment. I would give you a 3-page paper to be turned in next week. Double-spaced, New Times Roman, 12 font. 14 for those of you who don't want to write as much. But how does that phrase, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever," now affect you and your faith? You know that there are some people who don't pray it. And you also know that in many of the former translations, it's not there. Are you still being faithful as you pray it? Here's a better question. Is it ever wrong to praise God? No. God doesn't get weary with it. Will you please just stop? Now, I have a dog at home. And the dog will come up and lick my hand. Because the dog loves me. And maybe I'm salty. But there comes a point with the dog licking my hand that I go, this is disgusting. Go away, boy, you bother me. And when we praise God, when we glorify God for all that you've done and all the things you've been in our lives, God never says, go away, boy, you bother me. God inhabits our praise, loves our praise, delights in our praise. And there will be a time that Steve read about when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords will be glorified and the seal will be broken and there will be myriads of myriads. And there will be a day when we join that heavenly chorus and there will be a day when we will crown him with many crowns. And the world will be different. And right now, we have the opportunity to praise God. In this moment, in the days ahead, for all that God has done. Sometimes I hear people say things like, I just want to praise the Lord, 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 praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. For what? This week, as you praise the Lord, very specifically, what are you praising God for? What are the good things that God has done in your life, life of your family? Give him some time to praise. And that's something for y'all to think about. We're going to ask Steve to go to the organ. We're going to stand and we're going to sing, Crown Him with Many Crowns, the Lamb upon the Throne. It's on page 327 in your hymn book, if you'd like to follow along there.
Thank you.
of the benediction, I want to tell you that we're having a potluck right afterwards, so I'm going to, in this blessing, add the blessing on the food. But I also want you to know that before the service started, I was listening to Steve practice some of the songs, and he has got an arrangement of the doxology as you get ready to depart. So before you get ready to greet each other, you might want to listen for a minute or something, and then greet each other. Come on down for the potluck. We would love to have you as we sit down and have food together. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks and praise and glory for being the God of our lives, for sending Jesus to save us. Help us now, Lord, to be empowered by your Holy Spirit to live our lives. Give us opportunities this week that we don't even know about. Keep our eyes open and show us what is yet to be and the ways you could use us. Lord, for the food that's downstairs that's been so lovingly prepared, thank you. May it nourish us and strengthen us, and may the time around the tables be a time of delight as we talk and share our lives. And these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.